Ông quý chọc. Ông chúng ta phải cảm ơn tổ cái tâm lạc này tệ phí sạm lạc cả. Hay sạm lạc này bắt đầu tầng đi. Dường như mình là sầm nua và thông môi chùm nuôn tiết. Mình bấm nong xua từ lục ở nẹ chùm niến. Hay bắt đầu tầng đi cứ ông xông xua từ sự phơi mũi đầy mình chùm nong chương tha nẹ tu không ai cả hôm. Hay cứ xa lấy y bấy xa lạ mà phây buôn đọc bầm buôn. Hay sầm nua xua thả ta lúc chạp đau mà xe sầm phơi ní. Vì bên nào mà hay bọc phùm sai chỉ lực đồng bốn nơi xa nằm nà đá.
Well, I started soon after my return journey to Cambodia in 1989. I left Cambodia in 1967, so that was more than 20 years. I got this letter, Henri Locard, Lyon. The letter joined me. And because one of my friends,
Henri Locard, Lyon,
who thought he died, had survived, and he met me. On the return, on this journey, as I told earlier, Meng Son wanted to meet me and said that he'd gone through this extraordinary experience through two marriage prisons and he wanted to write his autobiography and he needed some help. So we started quite soon afterwards, around 1990, and the book was completed early 1993, I think, because Meng Son by then was commuting between France and Cambodia, setting up a travel agency, so he was not always available. I taped everything he said, and reorganized it a little bit, but followed the political order, and once it was completed, I showed it the manuscript to Ben Kiernan, who said, oh, I interviewed that guy when he arrived in France.
Bên kia ta ở Mường Sơn chụp nước là ở nơi đặc biệt bản thân bà rằng
hai khi nhóm bạn bắt đầu lấy cả
nơi sắp hợp bình ngữ bắt nhóm tên nhạc bắt bùm sai mà chụp nước hai khi nhóm thật bản kia tất tùa dơ bắt bùm sai nơi cho nằm bà hai cài giữa buôn khi nhóm xong bình đất mơ bắn tay chân.
No, 1993, sorry.
1993.
That was a plunge into democratic Cambodia.
The most tragic and the most dramatic aspect of democratic Cambodia.
Well, it was the autobiography of Meng Son. Now, whenever victims or people who lived under democratic Cambodia write their own autobiographies, either they write it themselves, speech writer, book writer to help them, and certainly Meng Son could have written in Khmer, but he could not have as many Khmers. He was excellent at talking and speaking, but not so good at writing. So I don't think he could have organized the book by himself. So I recorded everything by question and answers.
And of course, what fascinated most was his
18 months, that almost half of the time of the regime was in prison.
Now, it was quite exceptional because
most people who process through the Khmer Rouge prisons do not come out and die.
In S21, nobody was released at all.
In all provincial prisons, there were some releases.
But
over the years, although the Democratic Kampuchea regime lasted only 3 years, 8 months, and 20 days, there were quite significant differences between the year 75 and the year 76. Most prisoners were victims of the old regimes, that is, the Republican regime, and people connected with the Republican regime and the Sokum regime, educated people, monks who refused to be disrobed,
ordinary people.
In the second part of the regime, from 77 and 78, the prisoners in Democratic Kampuchea tended to come from not just the favored classes, the elite of the nation, but all classes, and more from within the ranks of the revolution, the civilian, and the military. And you see that in the history, in the story of Mueang Son, very clearly, when he was in Tanay prison, most people were people like him. He was a technician, or you would call him middle class, upper class, and a few and after 6 months, he was in prison in December, sometimes in June, quite a large, I forgot the details, at least up to 50 people were released from Tanay prison. In other words, in the first phase of the existence of prison, they were the old favored classes. Like in all communist regimes, by the way, you asked me which other countries I've studied. Yes, I approached Democratic Kampuchea from the history of the Cold War. Therefore, the regimes closest to Democratic Kampuchea are Vietnam, communist Vietnam, communist China, the Soviet Union, and North Korea. So I have read everything I could read on these three of these countries. Particularly on China, because Democratic Kampuchea was modeled on China, a combination of the Great Leap Forward and the Cultural Revolution. So, similarly, in all communist regimes, the old elite, it was a revolution, a new elite came to power, and the old elite was got rid of completely, like in North Korea, and gradually, of course, in the Soviet Union, and, but not as thoroughly, radically, as in Democratic Kampuchea. Regimes were on the way to failure because they had not been radical enough, they had not get rid of the old elite sufficiently, and also there was this race with Vietnam was arrested again.
It was in a totally different setup,
different kind of prison. It was a bigger prison,
Chong, near Pinup district,
close to the seaside. And surprisingly enough for him,
in that prison,
there was a vast number of Khmer Rouge themselves.
Either Kamapibal,
that is Khmer Rouge, civilian officials, or military. The rate of extermination was much higher. In other words, virtually nobody was released, was freed, and most were executed. Now, how did Mung Son survive?
You could survive either because you were completely uneducated, a real proletariat.
Because some people were spared because they were able to do some repairs, or they knew how to repair watches. They knew how to repair motorbikes, bicycles, and that was the case of Mung Son, and called Uncle Artisan, or a specialist worker. So, and in the second prison, he was in prison alone, not with his wife, not with his children, or some of his children, as in the first prison. Now, all the people around him were killed, except because he was moved to prison into the Khmer Rouge, and he was still a prisoner of the Khmer Rouge. So what was interesting in this autobiography is one, you had the history of the Khmer Rouge prison and its evolution from the beginning of the regime to the end of the regime. Khmer Rouge revolutionaries, the Kamapibal or the Yotia, that is the civilian and the military, were mainly processed in some open way in S21. No. There were officials throughout the country, in practically all prisons, in 1977 and 1978, and I even found two or three prisons in the countryside that were exclusively reserved to Khmer Rouge. One was the Compton Tom, ex-colonial prison.
In Preveng, the center of Preveng, there was the first prison in which there were only Khmer officials. So I think that
If you look at the general population, basically, my Sidinsky, the demographer who made the most serious study of the victims under democratic gives the figure of about 25% of the population.
And say, nobody has reckoned
what is the percentage of
revolutionaries themselves who
I think it could be almost as high as 50%.
So if you,
because they killed their own people, particularly in 77 and 78, throughout the country, massively, of course, in the East region, with a big purge of the East region, automatically they were purged or killed without going through the
prison
process, purges throughout the country of the
Khmer
officials.
If you were an ordinary person, of course,
25% of the population by and large,
the best chance of survival under democratic Kampuchea was
this category of people between ordinary farmers, ordinary people, and the Khmer
Rouge.
That is, every people working in the technical services. The drivers, the car drivers, the lorry drivers, or the people who were fishing, or the people who were tending the electricity in Phnom Penh, the water services in Phnom Penh, they had the highest chance of survival. They were quite well fed, they could move, they didn't have political, they didn't have political duties, so that was the best chance possible. And that's why, you know, Lung Son survived, because he could do things with his hands.
បាទអរគុណហើយសូមឲ្យលោកនិយាយដែលសង្ខេបខ្លីបានហើយព្រោះនៅថ្ងៃមុខភាគីពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងសួរលំអិតពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងបញ្ហាដែលអង្គជំរាបបានសម្រេចតែងតាំងលោកជាអ្នកជំនាញពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងបញ្ហានេះហើយយើងមានសំណួរទួចមួយទៀតថាតើហេតុអ្វីបានជាលោកសម្រេចជ្រើសរើសយកចំណងជើងថាអ្នកទោះខ្មែរក្រហមតើ
That's a very obvious
English.
You know, Democratic Kampuchea was like a prison without walls. Everybody, including freedoms, had been abolished. But the ordinary people, whenever I went to any place, Special centers, we don't know how to call them because they were not prisons
in the normal sense of the word. Chẳng xua bà chạy lục đấy hay lục bàn chơi bà chạy mình hơi hay anh miền ca về bà hạ bà hạ lạc nì thì phơi đại miền nhầm lòng chương thá được không ai rú ngu lạc ca bọ prai chìa phía xa không ai nâng cứ cốc ảnh chàng chèng nơi tầm ai không ai gật hóm hay dương bàn xua tầm nua môn mà nhí lục bàn bà chạy vì bà nhà bẹp bọn thì mới nâng cốc ảnh chàng chèng này hơi xùm nua xua chạy tì xua thà ta sẽ phơi bì ni miền là bờ thiên là bọt rồi còn miền pành hà khó khăn này chẳng may đấy bạn chị miền lục đẹp trong chị thì phơi tiền pi các bạn thì lá thấy miền là trong lòng chướng khó khăn này hay tầm khăn nó cứ phở pi nó cứ chia ca miền ca của bạn muối nông ca dù đắng cứ đời xa pi tha được mai ru củ lạ đi tầm nô thua tầm bốn tha tá sự phơi đại miền trong lòng chướng tha không ai được mai ru củ lạ đi bị thay chỉ đầm bơm mì sa chân tập rám ta viêm viên này để mà đánh đấy bị nứng tập lục ai bị vô bàn thế nên sầm nua thì muối.
Alright, well, the Khmer Gulag is a summary of my research of the provincial prison, which I made. There are several versions of it. I think the first one is 1995, and then the one I kept revising it. It was published in an academic magazine called Communism in French, and it's just a summary of what I found by my investigation of the Khmer provincial prison system. My investigation of the Khmer prison system is incomplete, is
ហើយយើងសួរសិភៅមួយទៀតសិភៅដែលមានចំណងជើងថាកូនសិភៅក្រហមរបស់ប៉ុលពតឯកសារ E3/12/2
I started when Meng Son gave me the first slogan. And
I,
in this first book, there are just 3, 4, 5, 6 slogans.
Bit slow, pam pa muay de.
Everybody.
Đăng hay chăm.
But when I was starting on my investigation of the provincial prisons, that is the summer 1991, wherever I went, whatever province, whatever region I went,
people came out, particularly
people who had been adolescent under the Khmer Rouge.
And as I was interviewing them 10 years, 15 years
after the regime, they were in their 30s,
and they were
regurgitating the slogans that they had heard in their political training as children and adolescents. And I wrote them among books, and for fun. Why did I do that? Because as Nelson Meyer, I have been a teacher in university, and I had one colleague
who made a sort of compendium or a collection of extraordinary things that you find in students' essays, students' papers.
Sometimes, but in the 90s, we organized
the ideology of the collective life, the ideology of the community, the way of the world, 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 the
people made fun of the Khmer Rouge by not writing, of course, but whispering to each other counter slogans to make fun of the Khmer Rouge, and I collected some of those counter slogans. Needless to say, that these are from oral sources.
I did not go through the archives of the SOTM or SOTM to find
slogans or advice to interrogators or things like that. I made a point of it's just from oral tradition. What the people remembered
10 or 50 years
after the fall of the regime.
ហើយលោកអ្នកជំនាញឥឡូវនេះយើងចូលប្រធានបទមួយទៀតហ្នឹងគឺអំពីមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខឬក៏គុកនេះអង្គជំរះគាត់បង្កល់ថានៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងស៊ូនស៊ូន2/ស៊ូន2ដែលអង្គជំរះបានជ្រើសរើសយកតែមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខចំនួន4ប៉ុណ្ណោះមកធ្វើសកម្មភាពការគឺមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខក្រាំងតាចាន់មន្ទីរសន្តិសុខភ្នំក្រោលមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខអូកន្សៃហើយនិងមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខស-21
Yes, as I was saying earlier,
not a single individual
could cover the entire Cambodia and not even the United Nations Khmer Tribunal. So I don't pretend that I covered absolutely all districts and all communes.
And yet I went
to many places, and it so happened that the four prisons selected by the tribunal,
I came across them.
So I could identify. Of course, S21, I did not find anything specific that
It is not by far the complete archives of Kantachan. Or S21, only 6% were women. So this paper, it is not by far the complete archives of Khmer Rouge.
មានការចាប់កាន់ច្រើនហើយខ្ញុំចាំថាភាគច្រើននៃជនរងគ្រោះនៅទីនោះគឺជាអ្នកដែលព្យាយាមរត់គេចទៅវៀតណាមដូច្នេះហើយនេះគឺជាហេតុផលមួយសំខាន់ដែលត្រូវបានគេចាប់ខ្លួនគឺគេចាប់ខ្លួនអ្នកដែលរត់
Good to Vietnam. Discrimination in Vietnam and try to find refuge in Cambodia.
ខ្ញុំមានឈ្មោះ2ខ្ញុំចាំមិនច្បាស់ទេ
Fortunately the tribunal supplied me the province the region Aisan
មាននៅតាមតំបន់នៅតាមខេត្តគឺភូមិភាគអេសានខេត្តរតនគិរីមណ្ឌលគិរី
the commune which the tribunal for reasons I can't understand called sub districts
they always មិនដឹងហេតុអីដែរគេហៅថា Cambodia
And I found out that I have some information on these two prisons, and they are in my notes on the Aisan region. In fact, for Ratanakiri and for Kansai, or I forgot exactly,
it's the prison in
Ban Lung,
which
I have some information
គឺខ្ញុំមានព័ត៌មានមួយចំនួនផងដែរតើតើនឹងចំនួនអ្នកទោស
the buildings
ក៏ដូចជាគី
Also what you have to know is that Ban Lung
ហើយអ្វីដែលយើងគួរតែដឹងគឺថា
Ban Lung នៅពេលនោះ
គឺមិនមែនBan Lung បច្ចុប្បន្ននេះទេមិនមែនជា
set up
Ban Lung បច្ចុប្បន្ននោះឡើយគឺនៅសម័យនោះគឺលំផាត់ដែលបង្កើតឡើងដោយសម្តេចសីហនុ
who created the new provinces
ហើយព្រះអង្គជាអ្នកបង្កើតខេត្តថ្មីនេះប្រហែលជាឆ្នាំ59 60ហើយព្រះអង្គបង្កើតព្រះវិហាររតនគិរីមណ្ឌលគិរីហើយនៅខេត្តកោះកុង
កោះកុងនេះគឺជា new provinces where under the responsibility of the military in Sihanouk's period
ខេត្តថ្មីដែលបង្កើតឡើងដោយរដ្ឋបាលរបស់សម្តេចសីហនុលំផាត់ជាទីរួមខេត្តតែបានលុងនៅសម័យខ្មែរក្រហមក៏នៅជាភូមិទូចមួយ
There was a hospital, and behind the hospital there was this detention center.
By the way,
there was another place in Ratanakiri where people were detained.
But as far as I found, this was the only prison
in the whole of Ratanakiri. Similarly,
for the one in Khmer, now
what investigation that was given to me.of the investigators of the tribunal itself
concerning Khmer នឹងគឺស្រាវជ្រាវអំពីកោះញែកហើយនឹងភ្នំក្រោលអញ្ចឹងមែនទេខ្ញុំចាំមិនច្បាស់ទេ
Now Semenorom when the province was established by Sihanouk
ចំពោះសានមណ្ឌលគិរីនៅពេល
ដែល it's the largest
ខេត្តមណ្ឌលគិរីគឺថានៅពេលនោះវាជាន
ៅពេលនោះសានមណ្ឌល might have gone there it's very close to the Vietnamese border
ក្បែរព្រំដែនវៀតណាមគឺនៅជិតព្រំដែនវៀតណាមមែនទែន
ហើយ
ច្បាស់ណាស់ថាគឺខ្មែរក្រហមមិនចង់ឲ្យប្រជាជននៅក្បែរព្រំដែនវៀតណាមនោះទេហើយដូច្នេះហើយទើបគេផ្លាស់ប្រជាជនមកនៅឆ្ងាយពី
population
from down Vietnam
ឧទោដូចជាពួក
ជនជាតិច្រើនគេយកមកកោះញែកហើយពេលនោះហើយទៅកោះញែកខ្លាយទៅជាទីរួមខេត្តរបស់មណ្ឌលគិរីនៅក្នុងរបបខ្មែរក្រហម
electricity produces factory producing electricity a weaving factory where they made kromas
ទីនោះគឺមាន
another factory that made traditional medicine
ឧទាហរណ៍ដូចរោងចក្រផលិតឱសថរោងចក្រ
តាមកម្មាគ
ឺថាជាកន្លែងជាទីរួមខេត្តហើយគេប្រមូលប្រជាជនមកដាក់នៅទីនេះហើយប្រកាសថាវាគឺមានមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខមួយគឺមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខភូមិក្រៅដែលជាមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខតូចមួយ
detention center for the whole of Ratanakiri a model kiri
I'm not sure តែអ្វីដែលខ្ញុំដឹងគឺថានៅក្នុងមណ្ឌលគិរីគឺ miền mình tì sản xuất tầm môi nước tê khi nhầm thư đầm nà tam đầm rây chi tầm mật rây từ công nghệ từ mình đô kê rí nó kêu khi nhầm miền kru bà riêng khám ai mẹ gọt chùi khi nhầm hay gọt chùi bộ prai bì kì xa phân ông mà bì xa khám ai khi nhầm sạch đạp hay khi nhầm
chọc
tình nước hay khi nhầm rực khơi nhầm bì bò mê tăng ngọt này
bà con đã hay xong lúc có sẵn khai bà bà này để nhầm anh chẩm đẹp chẳng nhầm miền thờ xua bà thăm thế hay tầm nua lòng ất đã vẹp bòn thì mùi nâng ông hai tương lai đây chứng ban cầm nọt ông mạnh nếp hai chìa phía kì nâng tầm nông chìa nâng xua lúc lòng ất bà nhà này hơi hay mùi tiết này tam ca sắc xa xa ra ưu chìa yêu xoay dù là bọt lúc nè để lúc bàn thư để tòa luôn ai nâng thá lúc bàn thư ca sắc xa ra chìa lưu mình tì xoay xoay nơi trong tu theo vật tê được cầm chia bị chia tay nước ban hai phần màn đấy miền trung luôn hai phần màn đấy
well I defy anybody to be able to come out with even an approximate number.
What was certain
is that there was one important person at the peak of the pyramid. This is, of course, S21. And contrary to all the other prisons, it covered the entire country. In other words, it received people from the whole country. As far as regional prisons, they were prisons per Khmer. Khmer, which in Khmer means region. Regional prisons, I could identify a few, like the ex-colonial prison in Siem Reap was the prison of the north. And I found prisoners who came from as far as Rovian in Preavihir prison. They were sent to Siem Reap prison.
Below,
so eventually there was a major prison for each region. As far as Dambon, which is untranslatable, which is an administrative division that did not exist before the Khmer Rouge and did not exist after. There were Dambon prisons, and I have sometimes identified some prisons which were said to be Dambon prisons. What is, when we come to the next administrative division, it's clearer the Srok or district. Now, the Srok and district existed before the Khmer Rouge and existed after the Khmer Rouge. Although now, the PRK period, the People's Republic of Cambodia, divided the number of Srok, so there are more Srok today than there were under Democratic Cambodia. From the evidence I found, there were about 150 districts, 150 Srok at the time of Democratic
Cambodia.
And I am sure that the Srok was, from the point of view of security, from the point of view of public works, from the point of view of party celebrations, a very important center, very important administrative division. It had its own band, or music, it had its own organization of workforce, it had its own prison. So every district had a district prison. And in some districts, there was at least one. And in some districts, there were several district prisons, like in Kompong Thom or in Kompong Chnak, in the center. As Rai Sivinsky has shown very well in the extermination of Cambodia, the closer to the center you are Cambodia, the more the highest the around the Tonle Sap and the Tonle Mekong, the more concentration of population you have, the more towns and villages, and the further you are from the center, the more forest you had, you no longer have today, the more forest and the less population. So of course the density of the prisons were much higher in the center of the Cambodia than in the outlying regions. This is why it was impossible that in Mondonkiri there was just one prison. Mondonkiri was a dambon, curiously enough, but a huge one. I think it's 105, and it covered a whole province. The provinces are supposed to have disappeared under democratic Cambodia. Now, when we come to the people's communes, Sahakor, which, as you know, I refuse to call cooperatives because nobody ever cooperated. I mean, there were cooperatives in Cambodia before the Khmer Rouge regimes. There are cooperatives after the Khmer Rouge regimes. But under the Khmer Rouge regimes, there were no cooperatives. There were collectives. Everything was collectivized. Collectives, as they were modeled on China. In China, you call them the people's communes. Now, every people's commune, which regrouped at the beginning, was just one village, then three villages, then five villages were bigger and bigger. Each people's commune had a police. A police center in which the people who were accused, who were tied, were first brought. So, if you ask me the number of prisons, at least permanent, I say permanent institutions, because so many places was used temporarily to shut up a number of people, that it is unaccountable. Even Princess Moniret, for instance, who lived in a big house on Norodom Boulevard at the beginning of the regime, apparently, so said, Dutch recently, last June, Princess Moniret's house served as a prison. Right. But that I don't count. That I don't count. It's just temporary. You put a number of prisoners in that place. Now, a permanent, that is, with an existence, some of them existed before the fall of the regime, but existed throughout the country. There was at least one district, so that's at least 150, to which you add all the Sahakor, number of Sahakor, I don't know, but it goes into hundreds or thousands. So my answer is, I cannot answer the number of prisons. If some institutions give the number of 196, this is pure fantasy.
Cục tài tầm mà rồi cao sắp rồi mùi đôi trẻ kỳ lực lái rồi coi dạng nào thế
bà ốc quân này lục bàn thuộc cả thật xa trái triều trả ấn tụi bây chùm nguồn trẻ lẽ lục mặt bàn đăng cả đói bàn tay tăng bài điệp rộp rồi bà lục nông thông thần đại trình đại chùm điên nhí mà hai anh thà lục bàn thật cả phai dùl làm bì mặt đà mặt tí sân ở dọc kỳ trả ấn tụ tiền bà tì nơi thầm mây cảm bà chìa bà chìa bà tay ហើយនៅក្នុងនោះគឺមានរៀបរាប់តាំងពីកម្រិតថ្នាក់ភូមិភាកំផងដែរប៉ុន្តែមានចំនួនតិចប៉ុន្តែលោកបានបង្ហាញថាមានហើយដូចជានៅសៀមរាបជាដើមតាមយើងចង់ដឹងបន្ថែមបន្តិចទៀតថាតើតាមការសិក្សាស្រាវជ្រាវរបស់លោកនោះលោកអាចរៀបរាប់ឲ្យសង្ខេបលំអិតធ្វើការប្រៀបធៀបរបៀបខុសគ្នារវាងមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខដែលមាននៅក្នុងរបបកម្ពុជាជាប្រទេសជាពិសេសកម្រិតរដ្ឋសម្ព័ន្ធគ្រប់គ្រងមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខ ភូមិភាកឬក៏មានទីសន្តិសុខយោធាហ្នឹងវាមានខ្ញុំចំណុចឬក៏មានចំណុចដូចគ្នាឬក៏ចំណុចខុសគ្នាអញ្ចឹងយ៉ាងម៉េចខ្លះដែរបើតាមការសិក្សាស្រាវជ្រាវរបស់លោកសូមលោកឆ្លើយសង្ខេបបានហើយបើសិនជាលោកអាចឆ្លើយបាន
Well, you are asking me to recite by heart my paper called The Khmer Rouge Gulag. This is exactly what I do in that paper.
Khmer Rouge Gulag.
As I'm not allowed to read the paper, and we don't have time to read that paper, what remains in my memory is that there were certainly very unequal in size and in importance.
Some
prisons, the last two prisons that were named, but chosen by the tribunal, the one in Ratanakiri and the one in Mondulkiri, I would put in the last tier, you know, the least important. There were the prisoners were less than, certainly less than 100 or even less than 50. In these prisons, some prisoners were released quite often. The tortures were very simple, mainly beating and using plastic bag. In no provincial prisons, the prisoners wrote themselves their own autobiography. This is an invention of Dutch, and this applies only to S21. Everywhere else, it was scribes or whatever you call them, who were writing the answer or summary of the answers in school children's notebooks.
In the simple first-tier prisons,
there could be just one person asking the question, threatening to beat, and writing down. Now, that's the first tier. In the normal district prison, you have at least three people. Well, first of all, there are more inmates. You have the problem of knock chu or knock dag, that is, I don't know how to call it in English or in French, the knock. These are the iron used to tie people or in wood.
Now,
the knock chu in wood, this was a tradition in Cambodia since times immemorial, in Europe. The people usually are always put in the smaller prison, the knot might be just in wood. But in the normal prison, district prison, they are almost invariably in iron. Now, for interrogations, you have always at least three people, one who asks questions, one who writes in the notebooks, and one who hits or threatens to hit. Or sometimes you have more than three people. Right, but the average is three, as is very well explained in Mungsod's testimony at Chong, and Taneng. This pattern is repeated throughout Cambodia. Now, above that, you have more bigger prisons in which the inmates might be into the hundreds and even up to 1,000. This, I think, was the case of Siem Reap prison, from which I have written,
and for which
the tribunal has had excellent witnesses. The turnover was quite rapid. People were interrogated over a period of just 1, 2, or 3 days, because room had to be made for new inmates.
The people
usually did not survive more than a maximum of 3 months.
But the average, would be 3-4 weeks,
and people were reprocessed. And people everywhere were liberated. Quite a significant number of people in the first year or so or two of the regime, and much fewer people, as I said earlier, in 77 and 78. When they were freed, they were not automatically sent back to their people's communes. They went through sometimes a kind of re-education camp that served as a link between the prison and back to civilian. Some of these prisons are very massive, particularly in the northeast, I'm thinking of Sisapon and Kralang district in Siem Reap. Where you had so-called refuel or ovens, very big open pits. There were three operating in alternatively. There was a big plank thrown across. The victims were put on the plank and died and into the pits. And then straw was thrown into the dead bodies, and they burned. And then after, the ashes were spread into the fields. Now, this was, and in Sisapon, the people were interred or buried with big machinery, not just by hands. So it was on, the extermination in the northeast were on, sometimes on a very massive scale.
ប្រះលោកពេលដែលមានអ្នកទោសក្នុងចំនួនដល់ច្រើនបែបនេះអរគុណហើយស្លូកាត់តាមចម្លើយមកភ្លឺបាល់លោកមិញហ្នឹងគឺយើងមាននៅពី3សំណួរចុងក្រោយហើយយើងបានពិនិត្យមើលនៅឯកសារពាក់ព័ន្ធនៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងហើយជាពិសេសនៅក្នុងដីកាតំណស្រ័យឃើញថាមានមធ្យញ្ញៈនាំមុខសសដែល
Well, I'm sorry to disappoint you, but I have not worked exactly as professionally and as technically as the tribunal has. I've not identified the name, I've not identified the geographical names of these places, but not their code names. I think that they might have different codes, or you might find traces of code names, but now we all know that S21 was for Sentebal security, and that 21 was the number of NAT. Now the idea of giving numbers to institutions or even to people comes from China, is modeled on China. You asked me which other countries I studied, I told you already. The other, I tried to compare democratic Cambodia with other communist countries. Now China has an absolute mania for giving numbers to places and to people. Apparently I read somewhere, surprisingly, that Mr. Mao Zedong was called Mr. 87. So one question that I'm asking myself is if, as the Khmer, I suppose, with Indians, are supposed to have invented the zero, I wonder if 87, you know, Munti 87, the party center, the Politburo, the standing committee, nobody knows how to call it, got the idea from Mao, you know, to call it. We shall do like Mao 87, but we shall do infinitely better than the Chinese. So that was, would be the origin of 87. So on the code numbers of the local prisons, I'm sorry, Mr. Judge, I did not investigate.
អរគុណអរគុណមិនអីទេដោយសារបញ្ហានេះវាពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខបានយើងក៏សួរបញ្ជាក់បើមិនទានលោកមិនបានដឹងឬមិនបានសិក្សាត្រៃជ្រាវបញ្ហានេះក៏មិនអីដែរហើយយើងក៏មានសំណួរមួយទៀតដែលពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងអ្វីដែលលោកបានផ្ដល់សិក្ខាកម្មអធិប្បាយយ៉ាងច្រើនមកនេះហើយលោកបានសិក្សាលើទីតាំងជាច្រើននៅក្នុងតំបន់ផ្សេងៗនៅក្នុងប្រទេសកម្ពុជាដែលជាមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខត្រូវរួមទាំងមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខដែលត្រូវបានចាត់ ណៈអនុក្រមលក្ខណៈជាប្រព័ន្ធដែរឬទេហើយបើសិនបើបញ្ជាក់បញ្ហានេះថាតើអាច prab dong chim reh thamnaka te tha ta bokul na dael krup krong leu propon ni hai tha ta ongka ong het na khla rue ko phos tang na khla dael ban dael phaek leu mulathan nei ka krup krong lakana chi propon ni
Well, if you start from the grassroots, I didn't study Democratic Cambodia from
Phnom Penh,
from the leadership, from the provinces, from the communes, from the people's communes, and from ordinary people. There was when an accused was being brought.
There was never any
accusation made to that person. It was up to the prisoner to say why he had been arrested.
So the first question was always asked, why did you tell us why the same question is asked everywhere, it means that the same directive or guidelines
must be given to be Santibal throughout the country.
I am so true
that this was similar in other communist
countries. The Soviet Union was brought to these
detention centers. You were not accused of anything specific, but you had to confess. The plastic bag, 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 the plastic bag Said that he was an equivalent to Heng Samrin, he said recently. I was a military leader, although he was a teacher. He was part of the Yotia or military makeup.
Yes.
In democratic Cambodia, you have the Kamapibal, the civilians, and you have the military. There was no police. The police was the army. The army was in charge of external security and internal security. And apparently, the army was only the armed arm of the party. In other words, they had blindly to obey the party. And this is what Butch said, at this place last month. I found it hard to believe. But I found, when I revised my notes of Bopia region, the East region, I saw some people making exactly the same declaration. We, the soldiers, we, the Yotia, do not make arrests It is the political commissar. The political commissar at the district level or at the commune level who says this person is suspect arrested. So it is really the civilian who make the decisions. And as you know, the structure of the power, which has been analyzed now for 7 years in this tribunal, so I'm not saying anything new, is it was highly centralized. There was no horizontal communication, only vertical communication.
So that to make sure everything is similar everywhere.
I am convinced that this was the case.
So that to make sure everything is similar everywhere.
បាទអរគុណហើយខ្ញុំអស់សំណួរហើយលោកលោកស្រីច្រកមានសំណួរឲ្យសួរដល់អ្នកជំនាញដែរទេសូមជួយលើកក្រុមសំមកឡើងវិញ